Hello and welcome back to Principles of Accounting 1. I'm your host, Dr. B. Today we're going to be talking about property, plant, and equipment, which are fixed assets. We'll also talk about intangible assets and natural resources. So when we talk about property, plant, and equipment, we know that those are fixed assets that are found on the balance sheet. And property, plant, and equipment are assets that are used by the business in order to help the business to generate revenue. We've talked a little bit about this in previous chapters, but we're going to dive a little bit deeper into property, plant, and equipment by utilizing this concept called depreciation. Depreciation is how we devalue assets over time because they lose their usefulness. We're going to talk a lot about that. We call these depreciation is considered to be the cost of the asset over time. It costs money over time to maintain property, plant, and equipment. They lose their value over time. Almost everything loses value except for the actual land itself. The property, meaning the maintenance of the property, the plant, the building, the building itself is the plant. Equipment, that's the equipment inside the building. Think of like a manufacturer, okay? A manufacturer has a property that the building sits on, the building itself, and then the equipment inside the building. And all of this is used to help the company to generate revenue. So we're going to talk a lot about that. We'll also talk about tangible assets. If something is tangible, it means you can physically touch it. It's actively used in operations. These are things I use in my day-to-day business to help me to generate revenue. They're used to help me to generate future revenue. We call these property, plant, and equipment. We use our property, plant, and equipment over time. Things lose value over time, okay? Think of your car. The minute you drive that car off the lot, it starts to lose value, right? That's just normal because it's wear and tear. It gets older. It loses value over time, yeah? So there's a couple of costs that are associated with determining how much value it's losing over time. Call this depreciation. Okay, the first cost you need to know is how much did it cost you to acquire the asset? In other words, what was the purchase price? What was the installation cost? The insurance to get it to you? Any other associated cost with acquiring the asset? That's your acquisition cost, acquiring the asset, purchase price plus taxes and fees plus installation plus whatever, right? The cost of you actually receiving the asset. That's computation, the acquisition cost. We take our acquisition cost and we allocate that to each time period the asset is being used. And as it's being used, it's losing value over time. It's getting older, it starts to break down, it loses value over time. It's normal. Same thing happens with a building, a vehicle, equipment. The more it's used, the more it loses value over time. That's normal. And at the end of its useful life, record the disposal cost, how much it costs us to scrap it and get the scrap value from it or to sell it. So the example I'm going to give you is a dump truck. I like dump trucks. Okay. I purchased a dump truck for my construction business. The dump truck cost me $25,000. That's my purchase price. Plus, I had to have the dump truck calibrated. Plus, I had to have it delivered to me. Plus, I had to have the insurance for it. Plus, I had to have it, whatever. Stuff happens to it. So it's the purchase price plus all of the additional costs required to get it ready for use. Okay? To get it ready for use. All of those costs together are what we call the acquisition cost. So it's the purchase price plus all of the related costs to get it ready for use, for its first use. There are things like, equipment, that's my dump truck, right? It's the purchase price, $25,000 plus taxes, plus the transportation cost to get it to me, plus the insurance while it's in transit, plus any installation, final assembly, and testing. All of these costs make up the total cost of acquisition. And it makes up the total cost of my equipment, right? For that particular piece of equipment. What about buildings? Buildings, if you're putting up the building, if it's not already an existing building, it's the purchase price if it's an already existing building. Otherwise, you add up all your construction costs, plus brokerage fees, taxes, titling fees, attorney's fees, surveying fees, permitting fees, so many different fees, right? Add up all of those costs. Those equal the cost of acquisition for building. The land itself costs, has a cost to it. The land for the acre of land or whatever, right? You make improvements to that land when you acquire it. You grade it. You put a parking lot in, driveways, fences, walking, shrubs, lighting. All of these costs are associated with the land. And it results in what we call land improvement. Land does not depreciate, ever. Land is not depreciable. It does not go down in value. Well, it does, but it does not depreciate. Okay. Because land is what we call infinite. The soil is still going to be there, regardless of what happens to the building over time. So for the land, we have purchase price, commissions, titling, property taxes, surveying, title search, and whatever other fees. But land never depreciates over time. Land is land. The soil is still going to be there. Okay? In most cases. 99% of the cases is still there. Unless there's a sinkhole or the land gets polluted. Whatever. In most cases, we combine all of those fees and related expenses are allocated to what we call a lump sum purchase. And the lump sum purchase represents all of those costs together, and it also represents a relative fair market value. A fair market value is what is the market, what is the cost of acquisitioning that on the open marketplace? Open marketplace meaning, let's say you want to buy a piece of land. Well, you'll look at all of the comparable values in the area that are similar to that piece of land that you're looking to acquire. We call that fair market value. Here's an example. CarMax. You know them as one of the auto dealers. They paid $90,000 in cash to acquire a group of items. Land, building, equipment. They purchased land for $40,000, and they purchased a building for $60,000. So their total cost is $90,000 for their assets they're purchasing. But you'll see the respective apportion cost. 60% is going to building, 40% to land, based off of the appraised values. You don't have to worry too much about that. We're going to dive deep into that. Here's the important stuff I want you to know. Depreciation. Depreciation, as I had mentioned, is the allocation of the asset over time as it loses its usefulness. For example, you purchase a car. Let's say you purchase a car for $25,000. That car loses its usefulness over time. Why? You drive a lot more miles. It's a lot of wear and tear. The engine ain't going to last forever. It loses its usefulness over time. So therefore, your car depreciates over time. There are a couple of methods to depreciating the value of the asset over time. And I'll show you what that looks like. So the first thing we need to understand is the acquisition cost. You bought the car for $25,000. Let's say it includes everything you need, the taxes, the fees, the title, the delivery, whatever. That's your total cost, $25,000. We allocate that through the process of depreciation over time. And to do that, we debit depreciation expense and we credit accumulated depreciation. I'm going to talk about those accounts. First thing we do, figure out the total cost. In our example, $25,000. Then we figure out this thing called the salvage value. The salvage value is the scrap, also known as what we call scrap value. It's the value of the asset at the end of its useful life. That's salvage value. It's also known as scrap value. You'll hear it called a couple different things. Just know that it's the value of the asset at the end of its useful life. And the third thing to know is the useful life. How long it's supposed to last for. Okay. I'll tell you this. A lot of assets' useful life is given to you from the IRS. The Internal Revenue Service tells what the useful life is, expected useful life is, for most assets. It's through what we call the MACRS report, Maker's Report. And what that report is it's a schedule of the estimated useful life for most assets used by companies. So you'll see things on there like vehicles, machinery, buildings, etc. It's basically an estimate of how long we expect things to last for. There are three methods for determining depreciation. Three primary methods. First is called the straight line method. The straight line method is where we depreciate the asset over its useful life the same amount each accounting period. So each year, for example. Let's take my dump truck into consideration. I purchased my dump truck, $25,000. That's my cost. I have a straight line method. I have zero residual value or salvage value. $25,000 divided, and I'm expected to have my dump truck for 5 years. $25,000 divided by five is $5,000 per year of depreciation. That's straight line. Let's look at it using our example below. We purchased a piece of machinery for $10,000. It has a salvage value of $1,000. It's the total depreciable cost is $9,000. So it's the formula is cost minus salvage value equals the depreciable cost. Depreciable cost divided by its useful life, which in this example, 5 years, gives us our straight line depreciation. Units of production is the second type of depreciation. Units of production is a method by we depreciate the asset based on the units we are expected to, that asset is expected to produce over time. In this case, we have units expected as its base, 36,000. We'll talk more about that. And double declining balance. Double declining balance is straight line times two, basically. In the first year, we find this first thing we do is we find the straight line method, and we multiply that by a percentage. We'll talk about that. Let's go through each one. Sorry, it's a little blurry. I know it's blurry for me too. Straight line method. We take our cost minus our salvage value to give us our total depreciable cost. We divide that total depreciable cost by the useful life. Useful life in this example is 5 years. 9,000 divided by 5 gives us 1,800. 1,800 is our annual depreciation. At the end of each year, I debit depreciation expense and credit accumulated depreciation. In this case, it's machinery. That's the subsidiary account. We see that we're crediting accumulated depreciation. For most of you, these are two new terms. Depreciation expense is an expense on the income statement that reduces the value of our asset. We credit this thing called accumulated depreciation. Accumulated depreciation holds a negative balance on the balance sheet, and accumulated depreciation is an asset contra account. It contra flows with the fixed assets on the balance sheet. So it holds a negative balance on the under assets on the balance sheet. What that does is it reflects the reduction of value for the fixed asset. Cost minus salvage value divided by useful life equals your depreciation expense per year. That is the most simplest, the absolute simplest method out of the three. Very easy. Straight line means the depreciation is the same each year over its useful life. So here's how it looks. On the income statement, we debit depreciation expense, 1,800 each year for the 5 years which is the useful life of the asset. On the balance sheet, we credit accumulated depreciation, which we can see over time is depreciating the value of the asset. It's reducing our asset amount. How is it doing that? It is an asset account that holds a credit balance. A credit balance for an asset account reduces the asset. So that accumulated depreciation represents the loss of the value of the asset over time. It's depreciating by that same amount each year. We started at the total cost was $10,000. At the end of that first year, the value was $8,200. At the end of the second year, $6,400. End of the third year, $4,600. End of that fourth year, $2,800. We see that it's being reduced by $1,800 each year until it reaches its fifth and final year. We see that it has a value of $1,000 at the end of its fifth year. Why $1,000? You might be asking. That's the salvage value. That's how much it's worth at the end of its useful life. And this shows us, again, graphically. So it depreciates at 20% per year. How do we know that? Well, it's straight line depreciation. So how do I know it's 20%? We have our depreciable cost, $9,000. $9,000 divided by the 5 years is $1,800. You can do 20 over, if you do 100 divided by 5. 100% divided by the 5 years gets you 20%. So that's how you could figure out your depreciation rate per year. So that's straight line. Any questions on straight line before we move on to units of production? You're all still with me?
Yes.
I know we're getting into lunchtime. I know. I'm sorry.
We're with you, Professor.
And working. Yes, I know. Okay. Let's look at units of production. There's two steps to figuring out units of production. First step is we got to figure out the depreciation per unit. How do we find this? It's the total cost of the asset minus salvage value. So that part's the same, very similar to a straight line. But instead of dividing it by useful life, we divide by the total units of production. The total units of production are how many units meaning parts of inventory that we're going to produce and sell. Total units of production is the inventory over the year that we expect to produce and sell. Step two, to define the depreciation expense, we take the depreciation per unit and multiply that by the number of units produced in the year or accounting period. Let's take a look at our example. We have units inspected, 36,000. Our cost, 10,000 minus salvage value, gets me 9,000. 9,000 divided by my units. Now let's assume that we have 7,000 units that we're inspecting during the first year. The depreciation would be like this. 9,000 divided by 36,000 units gets me 25 cents depreciation per unit. Okay? We take our per unit depreciation, 25 cents, times 7,000. Why 7,000? That's how many number of units we inspected in the first year. That gets me 1,750. So that's just year one. Now remember, it's a five-year asset. So each year, I take that 25 cents per unit and I multiply that by the number of units that I'm inspecting in each year. Now we see it varies, right? It depends on the year. But we know, but at the end of the day, at the end of the 5 years, I need to have inspected the 36,000 units. So 25 cents times the number of units inspected gets me my depreciation expense. At the end of year five, we add up all of our depreciation expense. We get to 9,000, which is its value at the end of year five. And then we have a book value of 1,000. Remember, the book value is the salvage value at the end of year five. And another way to look at this is we have our total book value. We purchased the asset for $10,000. At the end of each year, I subtract my book value minus depreciation. Minus my accumulated depreciation equals the book value for the end of that year. Take that value minus the depreciation gets me book value. Take that book value minus depreciation gets me that book value, so forth and so on. Until I reach the end of its useful life. Okay. The third, everyone understands units of production?
So this one is done periodically, correct?
It's done at the end of each year. So, so at the end of each year, we identify the number of units that Well, technically, it's at the beginning of each year. The number of units we plan to inspect or plan to produce, right? So we identify the number of units we plan to produce in each year. We multiply that by the depreciation per unit to get my depreciation expense for that respective year. And we do this at the end of each year.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, you're welcome. Great question. Until, of course, the value reaches either zero or its salvage value. Yeah, excellent question.
Professor.
Well, yes.
Yes, I have a question. So all these three methods, right? Mm-hmm. Are they all going to give us the same answer, or are they like all trying to solve different things?
Yeah, so great question. So the depreciation expense will be different for each method. So for straight line depreciation, our depreciation expense was $1,800 per year. Under units of production, we see that it's different for each year. 2019 was $1,750, 2020 is $2,000, 2021, $2,050, 2022, $1,750, 2023, $1,250. So it's different for each year. And we'll also see that when we look at double declining balance, it's different for each year. The reason why we have three different methods is the business will select one of those methods for that respective fixed asset. And that expense is going to be different depending on the method that they select. The reason for that is businesses have the ability to write off depreciation in their taxes. And that's why there's three different methods.
So it basically depends on the type of assets, right?
Yeah, that's right. And it also depends on the business's preference. They can select which one they want to use. Yep.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, great question. So the third method is called the double declining balance method. It's exactly what it sounds like. It's double declining. It goes down faster, right? The depreciation is faster up front. And I'll tell you the reason why a business would select double declining balance over straight line depreciation is because during the first few years, the business has the ability to write off a higher amount of depreciation within those first few years. And that's why this is probably the most selected method. So here's how it works. You have your information, cost, salvage value. Cost minus salvage value equals depreciable cost. Useful life is 5 years. Units inspected 36,000. Here's how the double declining balance works. The first thing you need to do, step one, figure out your straight line rate. What's our straight line rate, you might be asking? We take 100% divided by the number of years useful life. In this example, 5 years. 100% divided by 5 years is 20%. 20% each year for 5 years equals 100% of the asset. Makes sense. Step two, we find the double declining balance rate. What does it mean? It's double declining. In other words, it's the straight line rate times two. It's double, right? So two times straight line rate, so two times 20% equals 40%. 40% is my double declining rate. To find the depreciation for each year, we take 40% times the 10,000 and get to 4,000 for the first year. So our cost times 40%. Why 40%? It's double declining rate. It's your straight line rate times two. Straight line rate in this example is 20%, times two is 40%. My first year depreciation expense is $4,000. $10,000 minus $4,000 equals $6,000 book value. The next year, I take my $6,000 book value times 40%. My depreciation expense for year two is $2,400. And then so forth and so on. Until it reaches 1,000, then 9,000 matches. Now let's compare the three methods. Straight line, it's the same each year. Units of production, based off of the number of units produced each year. Double declining balance, it's double declining until it reaches its value. In comparing the three, there's a reason why a company might select one over the other. Straight line, it's the easiest. That's why most companies use straight line. It's very simple. Cost minus salvage value divided by number of years. Easy. Units of production, a little bit more complicated. You got to estimate how much you're going to produce each year, multiply that by the unit depreciation amount, a little bit more complicated. Double declining balance, also pretty popular. They say it's less popular than units of production. I don't think so. I think it's a little bit more popular than that because the advantage there is they get to have more deductions in the taxes based off of depreciation. That's why I think it's a little bit more. So for tax reporting reasons, we use this, I had mentioned this, it's called the Maker's Reports from the IRS. It tells us how long things should last. It gives us the estimated useful life. And we use that in the tax write-off process. That's all you need to know about that. There's not much to it. I'm not going to have you look at it because it's very complex. Depreciation for partial years. Okay, so let's say I bought my machine late in the year. I bought it on October 1. Well, if I bought it on October 1, there's only 3 months in the year at that point, October, November, December. That's assuming I put it in operation on October 1. So we have to find partial years, we call it. Basically, it's the number of months I've been using it during that year. Using the straight line method, it's pretty easy. Cost minus salvage value gets me depreciable cost divided by number of years, 1,800. I could divide that 1,800 by 12 to get me my monthly depreciation expense, and then multiply that by 3 in order to get $450 for those 3 months. So 9,000 divided by 5, that's 1,800 times 3 over 12. You could do it that way, or you can just take 1,800 divided by 12 to get monthly and then multiply by 3, whichever you prefer. But either method, you'll get to 450. And that would be the amount for that first year because I only used it for 3 months. There's changes in estimates. We fully expect that the number of units I plan to produce is not always going to be the same. So there's going to be a change. Predicted sales value might be, salvage value might be different. Useful life might be a little bit different depending on modifications. So there's changes. When there's a change, we need to account for it, of course. Okay, let's say at the end of the third year, my piece of machinery has a book value of $6,400. Cost was $10,000 minus $3,600 accumulated depreciation, $6,400. At that time, the remaining useful life is 4 years. We estimated the salvage value would be revised downward from $1,000 down to $400. So, of course, that would change the depreciation for that year. So, $6,400 minus $400, which is the difference. I'm sorry, the remaining salvage value divided by 4, which is the remaining useful life. It's 1,500 per year for the remaining 4 years. There could be other changes too. For example, asset impairment. Impairment is a loss of the asset for whatever reason. Let's say it had a major repair that needed to be done that wasn't going to improve the value. In fact, it had the opposite effect. We would debit impairment loss and credit accumulated depreciation. Think of like a major repair. That's asset impairment. Capital expenditures. Let's talk about this briefly. Capital expenditures are purchases for long-lived assets. Property, plant, and equipment. Capital expenditure. They are improvements, modifications to long-term assets. Here's an example I could give you. When I was working at the hotel many years ago, in New York, it was a very large building. We had 21 floors, okay? It was a 780-room property, 30,000 square feet of banquet space. Here's what happened. One summer, I'm sitting in my office, and the chief engineer of the hotel comes to me. He goes, B, we got a problem. I said, what's up? He goes, well, the chiller's about to break. I go, oh, that doesn't sound good. I go, what the hell's a chiller? You know, I didn't know. So a chiller is a big thing on the roof of the building that keeps the building cold during the summer. Okay? It's like a big air conditioning unit, essentially, for the whole building. Right? He goes, well, it's about to break. I said, well, that's not good. I said, well, what's it going to cost us to get it fixed? He goes, probably about, $6 million. I'm like, pardon me? That's a big expense. So I said, well, what happens if we don't fix it? He goes, well, it'll break and the building will come real warm and no one's going to want to stay here for one. I said, okay. I said, well, how much does it cost to replace one of these things? He goes, about $30 million. Oh, okay. So we had to make the decision to repair or replace. Either way, it was going to be a capital expense. Capital expense is typically a capital budget. Is a budget that is reserved by most businesses for asset improvements, modifications, purchases. We call it capital, right? Capital budget. It's big purchases. How much did it really cost? We ended up fixing it. So it ended up costing us about $6 million to fix it. And then ultimately it ended up breaking anyway. So we had to replace it a couple years later. We lost bad on that deal, but that's the hard thing. It's a chiller. A chiller is real expensive in the first place. Anyway, so capital expenditures come out of the capital budget that's reserved for the business to make things like purchases of property, plant, and equipment or improvements to those things. Revenue expenditures. Revenue expenditures. These are expenses that happen during the accounting period. These include things like repairs and maintenance. Repairs and maintenance are not capital expenditures. They're just simply, you're changing the oil. You're replacing a broken belt. You're replacing a window. Whatever, right? It's just minor expenses. That's just to keep up on the repairs and maintenance of your assets. Capital expenditures, these are like long-term things, like repairing or replacing a chiller to extend its useful life, an engine overhaul for a piece of machinery that extends its useful life. It benefits the asset. That's what a capital expenditure is. And that's really the difference between the two. So if it's a revenue expense, meaning it's simple repairs and maintenance, doesn't increase productivity. It doesn't extend its useful life. Just repairing and maintaining the asset. But if it's an extraordinary repair, it means it's a capital expenditure. It extends its useful life. and that's a major overhaul or partial replacement of the asset. If it's a regular repair and maintenance, we debit repair and maintenance expense and we credit cash. If it's a capital improvement, we debit the machinery and credit cash because we're extending its useful life. What about when it comes time to dispose of an asset? We dispose of an asset by either selling it or scrapping it to get it off of our books. And we do that through journal entries. If we're receiving cash, we debit cash and we credit the asset to remove the asset. If we're receiving cash, we record the gain. If it's a gain or if it's a loss. If it's a gain on the asset, that means we're selling it above its market value before it's fully depreciated. It's a gain, right? If it's a loss, we're selling it below its useful value, below market value, scrap value. It's a loss. Gain, loss. When it's fully depreciated, it's worth its salvage value, right? It's worth its scrap value. When the asset's fully depreciated, we follow the reversing entry process to remove it from our books. Okay, so what happens at the end of year five? It reaches a value of zero, we'll say. It's not worth anything. We have to remove it from our books. How do we do that? We will debit accumulated depreciation and credit the asset account, the equipment account. What that does is it removes it from our books. And that's what that looks like. Debit accumulated depreciation, credit the asset, in this case machinery. If it's not fully depreciated, there's a couple of additional entries we need to make. We debit depreciation expense, credit accumulated depreciation for the depreciation up to that date of removal or therefore. We debit accumulated depreciation, debit loss of disposal of equipment, and credit the equipment to remove it from our books. If we sell the asset at book value, we're obviously going to receive some cash. We debit depreciation expense, credit accumulated depreciation up to the date of the sale. We debit cash that we're receiving. We debit accumulated depreciation and credit the equipment to remove it from our books. If we sell it above book value, meaning we're going to make some profit, we debit depreciation expense, credit accumulated depreciation up to the date of the sale. We debit cash, we debit accumulated depreciation, and we credit two accounts. We credit gain on the disposal of equipment, and we credit the equipment for the remaining value. If it's below book value, it's the opposite. So if it's below book value, we debit cash, we debit loss on disposal of equipment, we debit accumulated depreciation and credit equipment to remove it from our books. Quick note about natural resources. Natural resources deplete over time. We deforest, we drill all the oil, we remove all the coal, remove all the gold from the earth. That is what we call depletion of natural resources. There's a method by that. We estimate the depletion per unit. So the cost of the natural resources minus salvage value divided by units of capacity. So, and this is used by like coal mining companies, oil drillers, other companies that extract natural resources from the earth. So it's the cost of the asset minus the salvage value divided by units of capacity. The units of capacity times the amount extracted from the earth equals the depletion expense. It's very similar to depreciation. Except obviously the earth doesn't depreciate, but the earth resources will deplete over time. Debit depletion expense, credit accumulated depletion, again, very, very similar to the process of depreciation. Depletion follows the same process. Okay. And of course, there's specialized plant assets that are required to extract natural resources from the earth. Real quick, intangible assets. The word intangible means I cannot physically touch the asset. Examples of this would be things like patents, trademark, copyright. These are intangible assets. I cannot physically touch them. They're typically classified as non-current assets. They also have a usefulness over time. They are usually acquired from other operations and have exclusive rights or privileges. Patents, copyrights, franchise licenses, trademarks, goodwill, right of use, leasehold improvements, research and development. These are all intangible assets. Okay, one of the last ratios to note is the total asset turnover. This is tells us about how efficient we are at using our assets. Take net sales divided by average total assets. Average total assets is beginning balance plus ending balance divided by 2. Sometimes there's trade. You know, you could trade plant assets for an exchange for newer ones. This is called a trade-in allowance. It's kind of like when you trade in your car for a newer one. Same concept applies. And there's a journal entry we would make for that. It happens from time to time. You trade in your car for a newer one. Works the same way. Okay, any comments, questions, or concerns? I apologize. We went a few minutes over. Anything at all? You're all good? Sure.
No questions.
Okay. All right. As always, I really appreciate your time today. We covered a lot of information. I know it was all done in a relatively short amount of time. If you have any comments, questions, or concerns, you think of anything, you need any help, you can email me, call me, set up office hours with me. All of those good things, right? So please reach out anytime that you need help, okay? I'm here for you 100% of the time. Just as a reminder, in the classroom, what do we got going on this week? We're in week 5. This is in module 3, week 5. You have your chapter 9 homework assignment and your chapter 10 quiz. 2 attempts, highest grade is taken on both, right? I've put in your new exercises to help you to better understand the content. Please feel free to use those. Walk through them. I promise it'll help. And that's, of course, based off of your feedback from the mid-semester survey. So, again, I appreciate all of your comments. It really does help us to continue to improve the course. And it helps me to be a better professor. So, please, if you need anything, you let me know. As always, I would like you to stay safe, wash your hands, do the right things. Thank you all so very much for your time today. Thank you so much.